Hi, everybody. Dennis Prager, a Good Friday. Los Angeles County, another hotbed of little people with power. By little people, I don't mean physical stature. I mean moral stature and wisdom. Fools. Direct the health of this county. Starting Saturday night at midnight, back to masks indoors in Los Angeles County. I can only appeal to all of you to disregard it. And if you are vaccinated, to particularly disregard it. They claim that every person hospitalized with COVID, the variant, of which there will be an unlimited number, it will be limited solely by the Greek alphabet. And then they will go into the Hebrew alphabet. And then the Latin alphabet. So they have many variants still available to us. They claim that every person hospitalized in Los Angeles County has not been vaccinated. To which one would then respond with two questions or two statements. Questions that really are statements. Why would the vaccinated then have to wear masks? If the only people hospitalized are the non-vaccinated, why are you burdening the vaccinated with this? That's really the question. But there are a lot of comments as well that I'd like to offer on that. If only the non-vaccinated are getting ill from COVID, notice I don't believe there was one death. And I don't know what hospitalized means. Does it mean one day? Does it mean a visit? Does it mean intubation? What does it mean? They don't tell you any of this. They just make it sound as awful as possible. The media is largely responsible for the hysteria. And the health authorities are made up almost exclusively of fools. And people will obey it. They got vaccinated. They're not going to get sick from it. And they will still wear masks. Not to mention, masks don't work. We're living in the age of the absurd. It's not only dystopian, it's something new where idiocy is proclaimed as valid. And my profound disappointment in my fellow Americans going along like sheep. What's the point of getting vaccinated if you still have to wear a mask? Seriously, what? I'm curious. Well, you say, well, it protects you from COVID. Agreed. I think it does protect the vast majority of people. I think there are side effects that the health authorities lie to you about. That's the problem for me. But that it works when it doesn't hurt people is, I have absolute confidence in that fact. You know, in South Carolina, they actually passed a law that colleges cannot demand that you get a vaccine before you attend classes. Why does that alone not tell you how superior conservatives are morally? UC issues vaccine mandate for fall term. That's right. There you go. That's California, University of California. That includes, first of all, young people should not be getting vaccinated. That I do believe. I've never made the statement about middle-aged and older. Because my belief is the chances of it hurting you down the line exist in greater doubt than whether you will be hurt by COVID now. Okay? I have more doubt about the efficacy long-term in young people than I do about the mortality rate of COVID in young people at this time. That's the reason. Especially young women, because we don't know the effects on pregnancy. A dear friend of mine died of two heart attacks, which is pretty rare to have them back to back. And turns out he was vaccinated. And a doctor friend of mine said, it's very strange to have two heart attacks in a row like that, especially while being hospitalized. And her first question was the man vaccinated? And I found out that he was. There are no free lunches, ladies and gentlemen. No magic bullets. It's the way the world works. South Carolina does not allow. College of Charleston will allow you, for example, is overturned. You can go. That's what you should do. If you want your child to go to college and you do not want your child to be vaccinated, which I think is the wise thing to do with regard to young people, then send your child to a college in South Carolina. That's it. For many of you, a degree from the USC on the West Coast sounds more prestigious than the USC on the East Coast, right? University of Southern California, University of South Carolina. I would trust the University of South Carolina with my child more, even though almost every college has been ruined in most arenas by the left. Nevertheless, just knowing it's South Carolina would give me more faith. You should not allow your child to be vaccinated just for the sake of going to the college you like your child to go to. That's a very bad choice, in my opinion. You may have full confidence, based on nothing that I have read, that it will have no long-term effects on, for example, as I said, young women and pregnancy. There's nothing you read that can even close to conclusively offer you that guarantee. Why would you give your child this medicine? To go to the college that you like your child going to. Go to a college you don't like your child going to as much. I will turn out to be right on this, as I have on virtually all these controversial issues over the course of a lifetime, because I have no agenda. My agenda is truth. It's right. It's very corny. What's true? Well, anyway, I welcome you to the program. 1-8-PRAGER-776. Masks as of Saturday night, even for the vaccinated in Los Angeles County, one of the most populous counties in the country. There will be, therefore, a mask mandate that will apply indoors when I walk into this building to broadcast. So I'd like to announce to the Glendale police and government I will not enter this. That ruins my workouts. I won't be able to work out without without a mask. Just as I return to the gym. No more gym for me. I'm not working out with a mask. Work out with a mask. It's a curse in many ways to live in this state. And certainly in L.A. County. Now, I don't understand. What county is San Francisco in? Is that King County? No, not Marin either. Marin is north of it. Anyway, Are they obligated to wear masks, or is it only L.A. County? 1-8-PRAGER-776. I'm Dennis Prager.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
And this is the destruction of a fair and independent judiciary. And this is using ultimate power to try to destroy political opponents.
100%, Charlie. And it's not like this is the only example. I mean, listen, if you've been watching for the last 5 years, look at the FBI. Look at what they were doing. You know, nothing happens. They can lie before Congress. They can go and do a witch hunt. They can all know that it's BS. They can all get on TV and act as political pundits and talk about things in a way that they know to not be correct. You saw that, right? They testified before Congress. No, there was nothing there. But on TV every night, they pretended as though Russia was a real thing.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Fiance? No, I can't be your fiance.
You're gonna go. You're gonna be my fiance, and you're gonna be the most amazing, fascinating, most successful man ever. We're only gonna be there for a few hours, eat dinner, and I promise we'll have the best breakup of all time.
My baby, my princess. Oh, yeah. Oh, no.
I'll pee a little bit.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
Things just happened.
My girlfriend and my best friend.
You got 30 days to grow up, son.
Nathan Hanning, it is good to have you home.
Nona, Nona, it's Nathan.
Well, you don't mind my giving her your room, do you?
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Donald Rumsfeld is famous for many things. Before Donald Trump, there was Newt Gingrich in the 2012 campaign, demonstrating hostility to the media and confrontation with the media. But before there was Newt Gingrich, there was Donald Rumsfeld, demonstrating command of the media. Most famous for his combination of command and concise knowledge is this cut, which is his most famous response to a question.
There are reports that there is no evidence of a direct link between Baghdad and some of these terrorist organizations.
There are known knowns. There are things we know we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns. The ones we don't know, we don't know. But,
excuse me, but is this an unknown unknown?
I'm not
several unknowns, and I'm just wondering.
I'm not going to say which it is.
But, Mr. Secretary, I'm right here.
See, Rumsfeld knew exactly what he's doing. It makes perfect sense, and that's why his memoir is known as Known Unknowns. But for the full tutorial on how to deal with the media, here is a press situation with Donald Rumsfeld on April the 11th, 2003. Listen to how he deals with a hostile press.
I picked up a newspaper today, and I couldn't believe it. I read 8 headlines that talked about chaos, violence, unrest, and it just was henny penny. The sky is falling. I've never seen anything like it. And here is a country that's being liberated.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on America.
Hi, everybody. Dennis Prager here. With a reminder that you can save a lot of money. Over the course of a year, you could save $800. This is real, actually. It's only $30 a month for a phone service. Keep your number, keep your phone, or get a brand new top-line phone, Android or iPhone, at a great price. You can do that, or just keep your phone, keep your number, and it's just $30 a month for unlimited talk, unlimited text, and 6 gigabytes of data. And if you go over on the data, they don't charge you for it. I tried it out. I couldn't believe it. It's the same service as AT&T, T-Mobile, or Verizon. How do you switch? Just dial pound 250 on your phone and say Dennis Prager. Pound 250 and say Dennis Prager. Pure Talk. It's a better service. So the CDC does not even have a guideline for indoor mask wearing, but LA County does. And Governor Newsom does not override it. I don't know if he can. Can he override it? Can a governor override a county? But he doesn't speak out against it. Because he doesn't care. He doesn't care. They don't care. Because in their own lives, they don't obey it. Did you see the plane load of the Texas legislators? The Democrats? Not one was wearing a mask. Not one. Packed into a private jet. Not one was wearing a mask. I wish I could just say they're hypocrites. They're frauds. And they're dangerous frauds. It's just constant every single day. Where did these Americans come from? It's like aliens have come to the United States and dressed up as Americans. This is so not the America that I grew up with. It's so not. When I say this to a young American today, they believe me, but it means nothing. I'll tell you what it means. When I describe the freedoms that I grew up with, and the love of country that permeated the society when I was a child, it is like when I was in the Soviet Union, and I told people, because I speak Russian, and I told people about American freedom, you know, private conversations with a Soviet citizen. And they did not understand what I said. I'll never forget that their reaction. They said, "Eta anarchia," that this is anarchy. What I described to them was anarchy. They could not imagine freedom. What the left did in the Soviet Union is what the left is doing in the United States. It is creating a new type of human being. By the way, they said that, Novi Chelovyek, new man, a new human under the Soviet system. There is now a new human in the United States, a meaner, more cynical, less American, non-freedom-loving human being. They are produced in the millions by our schools. They are produced in the millions by our media, governed by the mean and the stupid. So it's very hard to describe what it was like. It must sound stupid to them. God, when I was a kid, really young kid, but a kid, popular sitcom was called Father Knows Best. If there was a sitcom today about a father, it'd be Father is an Idiot. The State Knows Best. That would be the substitute for Father Knows Best. The State Knows Best. Yeah, listen to Psaki telling us, is this the one where she, oh, no, I have a better one than Psaki. Can you please get the New Zealand Prime Minister? I watched the New Zealand Prime Minister, and I'm telling you, having a background in Soviet studies, This is exactly how they spoke in the Soviet Union. She said, all truth comes from the government. I'm quoting her. All truth. So there can be no other sources of information on science matters than the state. That's what Pravda is. Pravda means truth. That was the Soviet Communist newspaper. And that was their view. We are the source of all truth. Why would we allow untruths to be spoken or printed or broadcast? And the Anglo-Saxon, the English-speaking countries, for reasons I do not fully understand, to be honest, are the worst. New Zealand is crazy. It's just crazy. And the people are fine with it. Yes, all truth. Doesn't matter how many doctors' credentials are invalidated by that statement. If you are a doctor or an epidemiologist who differs with the state, you are to be suppressed. Canada is a close second. Canada is crazy. Canadians have as much interest in liberty as I do in, I can't think of something that I have less interest in. Oh, yeah. I think, I can't think of something. I'm interested in almost everything. I read a book on eels this past year, as you may recall. So I really can't think of something that I am less interested in than Canadians are in liberty. That's about they've hit bottom. We're getting there too. We're not there yet. We have a robust tens of millions of Americans. If only they would all come out of the closet. Yes, all truth is located and told to you by the state. So I was telling you how describing my childhood to a young person today was like somewhat like my grandfather describing me life in Russia when he grew up in the early 20th century. I understood his words, but I couldn't relate to those experiences. 1-8-PRAGER-776.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Great. We've had 6 months of the new administration. It is the farthest thing from moderation that the government has ever seen, and it is the fastest track to extremism that we've ever had elected.
But Kevin, how did I know that in advance? Why in my debate with David French did I know this and you knew this? There was no question in my mind. So the fact that this has now happened, you know, part of me wants to say, ha ha, but it's just too sad to say ha ha. This is something that I warned against and you warned against and others warned against because we knew that the consequences are devastating.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
There's about 57 Muslim states in the world. There's one Jewish state.
The massive ingathering of Jews in the last 150 years back to the land is absolutely unprecedented.
They say that there's no greater sign of redemption coming than the Jewish people returning to the hills of Judea.
As a Christian, I've always supported Israel's claim to the Holy Land. To me, the Palestinians were just getting in the way of God's plan.
300,000 Palestinians are unemployed.
In spite of all the years of conflict, there's hope here, if you know where to look for it.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Topic. Yesterday, General Milley told a congressional hearing that there is no chance, not no chance, very unlikely and very little motivation for the People's Republic of China on this, the 100th anniversary of the Chinese Communist Party, to assault Taiwan in the near term. Quote, there's no reason to do it militarily, and they know that. So I think the probability is probably low in the immediate near-term future. Your reaction, Senator Cotton?
Well, I think that's right. Up through the end of the Beijing Olympics in February, Russia didn't invade Crimea, and 8 months before the Sochi Olympics in 2014, they invaded it 4 days after those Olympics ended.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Surprise!
Sharon and I.
Sharon and you what?
Things just happened.
My girlfriend and my best friend.
You got 30 days to grow up, son.
Nathan Hanning! It is good to have you home!
Nona, Nona, it's Nathan!
Well, you don't mind my giving her your room, do you?
Really, though, thanks for thinking of me for this position.
I thought about you first. Come on, growing up, I had a huge crush on you.
There are things that we all need to change about ourselves, but we can't blame God because He helps us change.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Larry Elder.
Sorry. I am indeed. I'm going to New Zealand now. The I'm sorry was dedicated to my producer, ladies and gentlemen. I want you to hear what I made reference to last segment, the Prime Minister of New Zealand, and telling the people of New Zealand where the only source of truth in New Zealand lies.
Of that information. You can also trust the Director General of Health and the Ministry of Health. For that information, do feel free to visit at any time to clarify any rumour you may hear, covid19.govt.nz. Otherwise, dismiss anything else. We will continue to be your single source of truth. We will provide information frequently. We will share everything we can, everything you else you see, a grain of salt. And so I really ask people to focus.
The most egregious example of that appears to be this.
All right. Oh, yeah. Should continue. The question's irrelevant.
Watch it. Hear the answer. A viral hoax in Australia and in New Zealand. How irresponsible is it the people that are sharing that news of a lockdown imminent in New Zealand?
Yeah. And look, that's the kind of thing that adds to the anxiety that people feel. So I continue to share the message. New Zealanders must prepare, but do not panic. Prepare. And when you see those messages, remember that unless you hear it from us, it is not the truth. And I really ask people, just visit
okay, unless you hear it from us, it is not the truth. I have lived long enough to see the Sovietization of Western countries. That was their message. Unless you hear it from us, it is not the truth. And you, some of you on the left, have the audacity to have contempt for the medieval church? What did the medieval church announce? Unless you hear it from us, it's not the truth. There is a very deep yearning in the human being not to hear conflicting messages and have to make up their own minds. Please give me the truth, and that way I could return to doing what is important in life. Going to a restaurant. Unless you hear it from us, it is not the truth. Well, what do you think, my friends? Okay, so let's see here. What happened to the doctor? There are a couple of doctors around the country who loathe me. And I want you to know that I have earned your loathing, because my contempt for what your profession has come to because of doctors like you is very deep, so the contempt is mutual. I think you've killed hundreds of thousands of Americans by denying them ivermectin, hydroxychloroquine, and zinc. You think I've killed Americans because I haven't advocated the vaccine. I've told no one not to get the vaccine, no one. I don't want you to give it to your children. I think it is a crime to give kids the vaccine. Crime. I think people should be brought to court and prosecuted for advocating it and for doing it. Well, I can't, not for advocating it. That's free speech. For doing it. Okay, so you think I'm killing people? By the way, there's no doubt there are people who are dying because they're not vaccinated. I fully acknowledge that. That's because I'm committed to truth. You're not. All right. Anyway, so much for that. Anyway, he hung up. This is a phenomenon. We are the only source of truth. Get that? Okay, let's see here. Ray in Livermore, California. Lucky man, lives in the Bay Area. See any feces today?
Say again?
Did you see any human feces today?
No, because I'm about 40 miles due east of Feces Town, known as San Francisco.
Right. That's an interesting thing. Every town, you know, like New York is the Big Apple, San Francisco should be the big fecal matter.
There you go, the big doo-doo.
The big doo-doo. Good.
And keep in mind, that's wholly owned and solely operated by Queen Nancy. So let's not forget that.
Right.
San Francisco, the city, shares the same footprint as San Francisco, the county, and it's a single city within that county, which is an answer to a question
you had earlier. Oh, thank you. That's why I didn't know what county. Good.
Yeah, and I'm not quite sure if they have the mask mandate, which is another question you asked, but it wouldn't matter because they're losing more people to drug overdose.
Yeah, stay on with me. That is a very interesting and frightening statistic. I was just on the Zoom call today before my show with the doctor responsible for Relief Factor. I'd never met him before, and some of those on the Zoom call spoke to me about him in his presence. He's in Washington State. And this is one gifted man. This is one great product. Complex, but works. ReliefFactor.com.
Remember that unless you hear it from us, it is not the truth.
Charlie Kirk Show.
And this is the destruction of a fair and independent judiciary, and this is using ultimate power to try to destroy political opponents.
100%, Charlie. And it's not like this is the only example. I mean, listen, if you've been watching for the last 5 years, look at the FBI. Look at what they were doing. Nothing happens. They can lie before Congress. They can go and do a witch hunt. They can all know that it's BS. They can all get on TV and act as political pundits and talk about things in a way that they know to not be correct. You saw that, right? They testified before Congress. No, there was nothing there. But on TV every night, they pretended as though Russia was a real thing.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Fiance? No, I can't be your fiance.
You're going to go. You're going to be my fiance, and you're going to be the most amazing, fascinating, most successful man ever. We're only going to be there for a few hours, eat dinner, and I promise we'll have the best breakup of all time.
My baby, my princess. Oh, yeah.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com. Streaming on Salem Now.
Things just happened.
My girlfriend and my best friend.
You got 30 days to grow up, son.
Nathan Hanning, it is good to have you home.
Nona, Nona, it's Nathan.
Well, you don't mind my giving her your room, do you?
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Donald Rumsfeld is famous for many things. Before Donald Trump, there was Newt Gingrich in the 2012 campaign, demonstrating hostility to the media and confrontation with the media. But before there was Newt Gingrich, there was Donald Rumsfeld, demonstrating command of the media, most famous for his combination of command and concise knowledge, is this cut, which is his most famous response to a question.
There are reports that there is no evidence of a direct link between Baghdad and some of these terrorists.
It's too short. It's too slow a version.
This is the famous version.
This is the famous version. I still. I don't know. Isn't that funny? Tony Bennett is great. All right. Be that as it may, there was a time when people did leave their heart when they left San Francisco. When I leave San Francisco, I can't say I left my heart there. Today's song would be more like, I wish I could leave my nose before going to San Francisco. Everything the left touches, it ruins. There is no exception on earth. Never has been. Okay, anybody disagrees with me gets on first, even if I don't know what they're disagreeing about. New Orleans, Louisiana. Jay, hello.
Yeah, before I get into the talk about
no,
the
no, vaccines, no, not before. Get into the topic or you don't talk. You have to talk about what you're told to scream at.
Okay, you understand how vaccines work? The more people that get unvaccinated, the more likely they become safe spaces.
Wait. It's a very bad connection. My friend, I want you to be heard. I want you to be heard. It's a terrible connection. Can you speak into the phone?
I am on the phone. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, there's no comparison. Now you're speaking into the phone.
All right. Okay. The way vaccines work, if more people don't get vaccinated, they become safe spaces for the virus. That means the virus can mutate and can become resilient to people who are vaccinated and thus become a pose as a threat. Okay,
that's not
how
true.
It works.
It's simply
so I don't
not
understand.
True.
Well, wait, no. So I don't understand why you
okay,
have a problem
you
with
said
young
isn't
people
true.
Getting vaccinated.
Okay, so
yes,
for the
it's
record,
basic
what I believe you told a nonsense. Go on.
It's basic biology.
Right.
Yeah.
okay, basic biology, that people who are vaccinated are likely to be reinfected by a variant because people had, did not take the vaccine, got the variant, and will pass it on to them because the vaccine is so weak that it can't handle a variant. Every single statement from the CDC has stated that it can handle the Delta variant, that the vaccine is perfectly capable of handling the Delta variant. And might I add, that if the vaccine is that pathetic that any variant will kill you, why take it? Okay, so that's it. Thank you for calling. Appreciate it. And let's see, Russ in Simi Valley, California. Hello.
Good morning.
Yes,
indeed. I was listening to a broadcast about Psaki saying that she's working with social media.
That's right.
To give them a list of things that we can or cannot say.
That's right.
And I went to this little book I have. It's called The Constitution. And I looked and it says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of, I just got down of a ladder, of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press.
Okay, so please understand a rule of life. Liberals believe in that. Conservatives believe in that. The left does not. You have the audio of Psaki saying that? Please play it.
Happen through members of our senior staff, but also members of our COVID-19 team. Given, as Dr. Murthy conveyed, this is a big issue of misinformation, specifically on the pandemic. In terms of actions, Alex, that we have taken, or we're working to take, I should say, from the federal government, we've increased disinformation research and tracking within the Surgeon General's office. We're flagging problematic posts for Facebook that spread disinformation.
We're tracking problematic posts for Facebook, and Facebook will of course go along. Well,
imagine if Trump had said something like that,
they would be impeached. Would have been impeached again.
It would have been pure fascism.
Pure fascism. Everything they accuse Trump of, they're doing. Everything. They're the racists. They're the fascists. They're the dictatorship. They're the suppressors of liberty. Country was a better country under Donald Trump. Those fixated on Donald Trump will have to answer to a higher being one day. Why did you not ask what's good for America? Why were you fixated on Donald Trump, the human, as opposed to what is good for America? Okay. What can I do, my friends? The human being is a flawed species. I've always known it. That's what I've preached all my life, right? The most important issue after God's existence is the recognition that human beings are not basically good. America had tried valiantly to create a good society despite human nature. It succeeded better than any other society on earth, which is why more people wanted to live here than anywhere else. And then human nature, in the guise of the left, took over. I sent you a book and author we should have on. Yeah, thank you. Great. A professor, I think. And he shows the roots of progressivism are so deep in this country. This did not start, my friends, with the baby boomers. My generation, the baby boom, we were taught. I remember having a social studies, that's what it was called, teacher in high school. And as a joke, we had a nickname for him, Lefty Louie. Yeah, in high school. He was the social studies teacher, Lefty Louie. Where did the baby boomers get their anti-American ideas? You think they made them up? Yep. It starts very early.
We shall return in a moment. I'm Dennis Prager.
The Dennis Prager Show, live from the Relief Factor Pain-Free.
Streaming on Salem Now.
There's about 57 Muslim states in the world. There's one Jewish state.
The massive ingathering of Jews in the last 150 years back to the land is absolutely unprecedented.
They say that there's no greater sign of redemption coming than the Jewish people returning to the hills of Judea.
As a Christian, I've always supported Israel's claim to the Holy Land. To me, the Palestinians were just getting in the way of God's plan.
300,000 Palestinians are unemployed.
In spite of all the years of conflict, there's hope here, if you know where to look for it.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Topic. Yesterday, General Milley told a congressional hearing that there is no chance, not no chance, very unlikely and very little motivation for the People's Republic of China on this, the 100th anniversary of the Chinese Communist Party, to assault Taiwan in the near term. Quote, there's no reason to do it militarily. And they know that. So I think the probability is probably low in the immediate near-term future. Your reaction, Senator Cotton?
Well, I think that's right. Up through the end of the Beijing Olympics in February, Russia didn't invade Crimea in the 8 months before the Sochi Olympics in 2014. They invaded it 4 days after those Olympics ended.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Surprise!
Sharon and I.
Sharon and you what?
Things just happened.
My girlfriend and my best friend.
You got 30 days to grow up, son.
Nathan Hanning! It is good to have you home!
Nona, Nona, it's Nathan!
Well, you don't mind my giving her your room, do you?
Really, though, thanks for thinking of me for this position.
I thought about you first. Come on, growing up, I had a huge crush on you.
There are things that we all need to change about ourselves, but we can't blame God because He helps us change.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for...
Hi, all. That's really sad about Sam in Chicago. His company says get vaccinated or lose your job. I guess that's legal, right? I mean, they could say anything. I mean, they could say get a tattoo or lose your job, I assume. Or get rid of your tattoo or lose your job. Does everybody at your company agree with that, Sam in Chicago?
Hi, happy Friday, by the way. To be honest, I haven't had the conversation with many colleagues. I kind of trust myself and I in regards to this matter. I kind of just lay low.
What did they actually say? Do you happen to have the written notice in front of you?
I do. Give me 1 second. I can pull it up. But it was a message from our CEO.
Are you allowed to say the company, or you rather not? I'm not going to press
you. I'd rather not say the name of the company.
Go ahead.
Just protect myself.
Right.
But it was basically, it started off with the CEO saying how grateful she was to get the vaccine in February. Fine, congratulations. And then based off internal surveys, 80% of the company is vaccinated, but now they want 100% compliance.
I don't understand then, it. I literally don't understand it. If it's not totalitarian and it's health, why do the vaccinated give a damn if 20% are not vaccinated, even and especially since herd immunity is 70%?
Well, and then I, on top of that, I reached out to several friends because, quite honestly, I have a non-lethal heart issue, and I'm worried about the heart inflammation reports.
I think you should be.
And I've reached out to friends, and some have been very sympathetic, and they've chosen to, but they agree with my right to not want to. And the other one's like, well, you know, they have to protect themselves. And then one told me, he goes, the vaccinated people protects other vaccinated people from the virus, but you can spread it to them. And I said, that doesn't make any sense. How can it, then it's not a vaccine and it's a very bad vaccine.
Right, exactly. I mean, it's actually scary, the number of Americans who spout literal nonsense. Literally, it makes no sense. You're vaccinated, that's it. What do you care?
So I wanted to
so go on.
I wanted to reach out to you to warn your listeners. I've listened to you for a while. Young man, 27, that this is coming, and I fear that Jen Psaki, the secretary, blew the dog whistle, and I find it very convenient this email came a day after she said, well, there's no federal mandate, but we'll support any private mandate.
Well, God bless your generation. People like you who value simple common sense, forget liberty, just common sense, you're going to have a battle in your lifetime. I'm Dennis Prager, and we continue.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Joe Biden was sold as a moderate. People that had worked with Joe Biden back in the day said, oh, I've known Joe for years. He's okay. He's fine.
Listen, when he got the hair plugs, he flipped. A long time ago, he was bald as an egg, and he got hair plugs. And I believe those hair plugs were from a Chinese lab in the Wuhan province, and things started to go screwy, and he flipped. That's
so he said. I don't know that that's true. I think he hid maybe who he was for a long time. A lot of liberals did in the 70s.
Wait. First of all, he's nobody. He has no values. Let's not kid ourselves. He's not a Marxist. He is a husk of a person, and he will just do – that's the whole point of your article at townhall.com. People are running him and steering him, and he doesn't have the whisper of what we would call courage or conviction.
Right. Well, and because he can't get the stuff kicked out fast enough. I mean, they've attacked so many different areas of culture and life all at once, and I think this is part of the blowback that is causing parental communities to rise up. You know, one of the things I'm most excited about, to be candid, out of all this, is to see the growth of middle-class black parents debating CRT to their own school boards. There's something very powerful about a father and a mother, married black couple, living in a suburb and being part of a community and saying to a school board, what you're in essence trying to do is teach my child to be a racist.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
Don't you get tired of commercials screaming at you to buy gold now with inflated promises on future values? In an unregulated industry, you need honest, real experts to give you solid advice to protect your wealth and top picks on the best coins and bullion based on real-time data and historical trends. For example, as environmental policy becomes a hot topic, one precious metal that's been significantly undervalued for years is potentially set to surge. Nick Rovich, owner of AmFed Coin and Bullion, has long recommended this precious metal, Up to 600,000 ounces of this rare metal will be needed by 2030 to produce green hydrogen. Nick is doubling down on this pick, and you should too. Call Nick at AmFed Coin and Bullion to find out more. I've been friends with Nick for years, and he's my go-to guy when it comes to coins and bullion. I trust him. He is a good and very knowledgeable man. Call Nick at 800-221-7694. 800-221-7694. AmericanFederal.com. AmericanFederal.com. Not one mistake.
Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
I had studied Marxist history, beginning with Marx and Engels' Communist Manifesto from 1848. And when I first studied that and saw in section one of the manifesto what you can recognize as what's called the oppressor versus oppressed narrative of human history, a whole bunch of stuff that was taking place in our country began to become exceptionally clear to me. And I began to piece together a lot of the what I'll call militant impulse that was manifesting in society as time went on. And there's a victimhood ideology. There's constantly an effort by some individuals who have an agenda to pit groups of people against one another as victims or oppressed groups and oppressor groups. And we've seen very clearly over the past calendar year who the oppressor group is labeled to be and who the oppressed groups are labeled to be. And right now, under the auspices of diversity and inclusion training, as well as critical race theory and other narratives of American history that have been parading about throughout the country and showing up in our education system, all of those narratives seek to divide the American people by pitting people against one another into racial groups.
Yeah, it is.
It's the white versus the black. It's the.
It used to be class, division by class. Now it's division by race, by skin color. We've only begun to scratch the surface. We're going to go deep dive on what's happening inside the U.S. military and why this man took the courageous step of writing the book Irresistible Revolution. Lieutenant Colonel Matthew Lohmeyer.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Some lawyer hit a little girl.
Former cancer patient Sharon Blackwell was struck by an oncoming vehicle.
Take this in evidence, sir.
I need to call my wife.
You've been accused of texting while driving.
Before you take your daughter off life support, give God room to be God.
You're not guaranteed another day. But you have today.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
One third of California small businesses will never reopen. One third. Many of the things that Gavin Newsom did had nothing whatever to do with science. You've heard me interview small business owners who said he imposed lockdowns and mandates and then loosened them and then reimposed them and then loosened them so nobody knew what the hell to do. The science suggested that schools could have remained open. We already have a situation where 75% of black kids in California cannot read at state levels of proficiency. Nearly half of all kids in California cannot read at state levels of proficiency. And yet schools were shut down for a full year. And the left is always talking about leveling the playing field, making sure that things are equal. How in the world are you going to get equal when you have prevented black kids, Hispanic kids, from having in-school learning for over a year? And everybody knows this video learning is not the same.
All right, here goes, everybody. It's the happy, 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 happy hour. Now, notice, the name of the show is the Happiness Hour, but the song is the Happy Hour. Yes, it is, everybody, because the happy make the world better, the unhappy make it worse. You have a moral obligation to pursue happiness. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So take it away, everybody. Yes, it is indeed. Okay, all, I'm Dennis Prager. Since 1999, the second hour every Friday is about happiness. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You know what giants founded this country? Giants. And the midgets hate giants. I'm not talking stature in terms of feet and inches, by the way. For the record, but midgets hate giants. That is one of the great rules of human life. They tear them down. Everyone who tears down the founders is a nothing, by definition. Anyway, life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. So today's subject, last week I spoke about living through your children. And that it's a bad idea. It's not good for you, and it's really not good for them. For you to be independently happy, and that brings your child a great deal of joy. So I'm talking today, I've never talked about this, I can't believe it, 22 years of the Happiness Hour. Happy parents, that's today's subject. The effect of happy parents on their children, or if you will, the effect of unhappy parents on their children. Do you know that in speeches on happiness, I have spoken about the moral obligation, as you know, the moral obligation to act happy and to pursue happiness, even if you don't feel it. And whenever I say it, I always give one example. Well, that's not true. I always give this example. I give others as well. I give this example. I say, ask anyone raised by an unhappy parent what that was like, and you will understand the moral obligation to be happy. So, that's the subject. The effect, maybe there isn't an effect. The effect of happy parents on children and the effect of unhappy parents on children. You've probably grown up with one of them. Do you know that only today, only in the last 10 minutes, when I came up with this topic with the living martyr, did I realize I was raised by two happy parents. Is that fair to say? You knew my parents. And I think that had an impact on me. And I never thought about that, because I've always thought, I've been very open about this, my parents were not demonstrably affectionate to me as a child. I don't say that at all as a complaint. I'm saying it simply that you will know that I didn't have an idyllic childhood. There, I don't know if there's such a thing as an idyllic childhood in any event. Might be a pipe dream. But I can say now, I would trade in shows of affection for happiness. I'd rather have happy parents who aren't affectionate to unhappy parents who were. How's that? 1-8-PRAGER 776-877-243-7776. That is another example of how important I think happiness is. I can only imagine, because I didn't have it, but I can only imagine what it's like to be raised by an unhappy parent. I assume that if you are raised by one or two unhappy parents, usually it's one, if you are raised by an unhappy parent, I would assume that among other consequences is you feel from a very early age that you have to make them happy. Does that make sense? So let me ask the living martyr, were your parents essentially happy? It's a tough one. Seriously, it's a mixed bag? Mixed bag, right. Yeah. Yeah, I don't remember my parents being unhappy. Though my mother claimed that my father was moody, but I didn't have enough interaction with him to really make an assessment in that regard. Well, that's an interesting subject. The effect of a parent's happiness on a child. So call in and tell me which was the case with you and what effect it had. Well, you may not have reflected on it, just as I didn't fully reflect on it until now. 1-8-PRAGER-776, 877-243-7776. The effect of happy parents and unhappy parents on a child. Remember I just said to you that if you were raised by an unhappy parent, because usually it's one. So let me explain that statement. Very rarely does the unhappy marry another unhappy. Generally speaking, the unhappy marry the happy. As I've said very often in speeches, the unhappy may be miserable, but they're not stupid. They never marry one of their own. I have never met two unhappies or two moodies married to one another. And I often ask couples, because I'm very open and their people are open with me, I will ask them, which one of you is the moody one? And almost always, they will say one of them is. Sometimes they say the other one, and the other one says the other one, which is a little confusing to me. But anyway, I'm almost always, hitting pay dirt there. On occasion, though, there are people saying neither of us is moody, which is very possible. But I've never had both of us are moody. So that's the reason I said one parent being the unhappy parent. This is so important, and I feel a little almost embarrassed, but I acknowledge things publicly, that I hadn't thought about this and its effect on me in my life. I've thought about the lack of affection in my early life, but I didn't think about the happiness factor. And that's a good thing, not to have to worry about your parents' happiness. It's particularly wonderful as they get older. God, if your parents, you're now an adult and your parents are happy, you know what a relief that is for you? Oh my! And I knew that I did know. I'm as a child, I didn't think about it, but as an adult, I thank God on a daily basis that my parents were so happy with each other. It was not only therefore just fun to visit, that was fine, but more important, they were not a burden at all. They were not an emotional burden on me. How many adult children could say that neither parent is an emotional burden? But every unhappy person is a burden on somebody. That's one of the reasons I say you have a moral obligation to pursue happiness. Because you just become a burden on the happy. All right, I'll take your calls. 877-243-7776. This is the Happiness Hour on the Dennis Prager Show.
Donald Rumsfeld is famous for many things. Before Donald Trump, there was Newt Gingrich in the 2012 campaign, demonstrating hostility to the media and confrontation with the media. But before there was Newt Gingrich, there was Donald Rumsfeld, demonstrating command of the media. Most famous for his combination of command and concise knowledge is this cut, which is his most famous response to a question.
There are reports that there is no evidence of a direct link between Baghdad and some of these terrorist organizations.
There are known knowns. There are things we know we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns. The ones we don't know, we don't know.
Excuse me, but is this an unknown unknown?
I'm not
several unknowns, and I'm just wondering.
I'm not going to say which it is.
But Mr. Secretary,
I'm right here.
See, Rumsfeld knew exactly what he was doing. It makes perfect sense, and that's why his memoir is known as Known Unknowns. But for the full tutorial on how to deal with the media, here is a press situation with Donald Rumsfeld on April the 11th. 2003, listen to how he deals with a hostile press.
I picked up a newspaper today, and I couldn't believe it. I read 8 headlines that talked about chaos, violence, unrest, and it just was henny penny. The sky is falling. I've never seen anything like it. And here is a country that's being liberated.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
When did you wake up and say, hang on, this is not good?
Well, like I said earlier, I've been in for over 15 years. The first 14 years of my career, I was in the Air Force, was in the flying community, and then came into the Space Force. Every unit that I've ever been in, all of my professional interactions with people during the preponderance of my career have been highly professional, not politicized. We focus on a mission that unifies us. We wear the same uniform and we go out and do our job every day. And when I noticed personally these things really rapidly beginning to change was in the past calendar year, but specifically in the aftermath of George Floyd's death. What you saw in broader society in the form of social justice activism pouring into the streets, the disruption of civil liberties, for example, and the dialogue, if you want to call it that, that ensued in the aftermath is the very thing that I saw just spill over into active duty military units. Now, I'll be clear that every unit is different, every leader is different, every base is different. But that's when I was really keen on seeing this happen. Now, I've been in academia for the past 2 years. And so what I'm able to share is simply one man's perception of when this is. I left academia in June of last year and came out to my current base and have had these experiences. But it's my sense that the seeds are planted long ago. This is a subversive agenda.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at Rumble.
it's Friday, and it's the second hour of my show. A reminder that you can have all the happiness hours, which is sort of free psychotherapy. I really do believe that. Millions of people do believe that. With Pragertopia, where you have access to all the past shows and all the current shows each day without commercials. Pragertopia, which is a magnificent gift too, and it's very inexpensive. Pragertopia.com, where I'm now putting up also longer interviews with people, fascinating people, also without commercial breaks. Pragertopia.com. I'm Dennis Prager. The subject is happy and unhappy parents. Whenever I talk about the moral obligation to be happy, or at least act it, I give the example of being raised by an unhappy parent. And then a lot of people think, oh yeah, I certainly wish mom or dad had felt a moral obligation to be happy. All right, John in Chicago, Illinois. Hello, John.
Hello, Dennis. How are you, sir?
Thank you well.
I just want to tell you, I really appreciate you and you all, you know, your life's work. You've been a very positive influence and help to me.
Good.
The Book of Proverbs says, iron sharpeneth iron, and men need other men to look to.
Yep.
That are men of character, and you provide that for me, and I really appreciate it. Thank you.
I've tried to. Thank you.
My father was 6 years old riding in a car. He was asleep, and he woke up because there was a car accident, and his father, who was 30 years old at the time, died in that crash. And that left him with his mother, who was bipolar, but of course there was no such thing as that diagnosis at the time. But she was a very unhappy person, and my father was very bitter having lost his father, and he also was bipolar. So I was raised by a very, very unhappy father, and he was quite torturous. He was physically abusive with me, and he was psychologically abusive with everybody else in the family. And I can tell you that the topic that you're covering today, I'm starting to get emotional. It's really important for your listeners to get this and get it right. And if you are an unhappy parent, you need to be careful about your behavior because it will affect your children in their lives.
I am happy that you broke up. I think you did a service to everybody. That's the recording I would play to prove my point about how important it is to try to be a happy person for other people. Man is 60 years old and he was brought to tears, memories of how he's raised by this chronically unhappy father. When I say things, I'll just acknowledge this and move on. It is not possible for me to know, as I sit in this studio with 2-3 people present, it is not possible for me to know how many people listening are taking what I am saying to heart. I don't know. So I need a call like that to really push the agenda. How important it is to others that you not be unhappy. Now, I don't have an answer to, well, what if you're bipolar? I don't have an answer. Are there people who are just physiologically incapable of even acting happy, or perhaps lower the bar? Are there people who are physiologically incapable of not acting unhappy? I don't have an answer to that question. be a very interesting one. In other words, is there a point in life with a psychopathology that is so severe that you cannot, literally cannot, stop acting unhappy? Now, I don't know the answer to that. If a person who is very unhappy, chronically unhappy, were offered $10,000 a day if they would not act unhappy, could they do it? I don't know. I'm posing the question. I would simply argue that to the extent that there are people who, for $10,000 a day, could suppress their unhappy behavior, I would simply argue to them that the psychological welfare of your spouse and children is worth $10,000 a day. Okay, Ken in Pasadena, California. Thank you for calling.
Hi, Dennis. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Well, longtime fan, big supporter of PragerU and Pragertopia, and you're just you've been a real light in my life for many, many decades.
Thank you for saying that. Good.
Anyway, I have a different twist on this topic. My parents weren't necessarily unhappy. I told your screener that I realized over the years the effect of my unhappiness on my own children and how the mistreatment of, especially my boys, came from a lot of lack of fulfillment from my marriage with, you know, with my wife over the years. And, you know, the analogy would be like a dog who doesn't get what he wants and becomes a vicious dog, aggressive dog, and as opposed to one that gets all the love and then, you know, fulfillment that it seeks. So in a way, that's kind of how I feel, you know, my marriage has been over the last 20 some years. And I told my kids that too. I'm very sorry for how I've treated my boys, and but I've, you know, lashed out at them many times over the years just from my what I feel is a lack of fulfillment inside me.
Are you still married?
Yes, I tell people, and a lot of my friends, the guys in my men's group and others all know that it's basically co-parenting. You know, we're co-parents. We live separate lives, you know, within the house. We're very civil with each other, do everything, you know, for the kids. Right. I'm basically just in it for the kids. You know?
I understand. A lot of pain in this world. We'll be back.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
If you're longing for a place that feels like pre-pandemic America, I'll tell you right now, Las Vegas is one of them. What's your community? Well, tell me what your town is like and how you would respond to being in a theater with 1,800 other people, elbow to elbow. Here's Mike. What's the upstate of South Carolina, Mike, life, Mike?
Mike, it is wide open for business, baby. We are rocking and rolling, and we cannot get enough people to work. So come on down here and grab yourself a job.
I love it. That makes me happy. Coming back to work makes me happy. Thank you, Mike.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Nothing. Joe Biden was sold as a moderate. People that had worked with Joe Biden back in the day said, "Oh, I've known Joe for years. He's okay. He's fine."
Listen, when he got the hair plugs, he flipped. A long time ago, He was bald as an egg, and he got hair plugs. And I believe those hair plugs were from a Chinese lab in the Wuhan province, and things started to go screwy, and he flipped. That's
so he said. I don't know that that's true. I think he hid maybe who he was for a long time. A lot of liberals did in the 70s.
Wait. First of all, he's nobody. He has no values. Let's not kid ourselves. He's not a Marxist. He is a husk of a person, and he will just do – that's the whole point of your article at townhall.com. People are running him and steering him, and he doesn't have the whisper of what we would call courage or conviction.
Right. Well, and because he can't get the stuff kicked out fast enough. I mean, they've attacked so many different areas of culture and life all at once. And I think this is part of the blowback that is causing parental communities to rise up. You know, one of the things I'm most excited about, to be candid, out of all this, is to see the growth of middle class black parents debating CRT to their own school boards. There's something very powerful about a father and a mother, married black couple, living in a suburb and being part of a community and saying to a school board, what you're in essence trying to do is teach my child to be a racist.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
Don't you get tired of commercials screaming at you to buy gold now with inflated promises on future values? In an unregulated industry, you need honest, real experts to give you solid advice to protect your wealth and top picks on the best coins and bullion based on real-time data and historical trends. For example, as environmental policy becomes a hot topic, one precious metal that's been significantly undervalued for years is potentially set to surge. Nick Rovich, owner of AmFed Coin and Bullion, has long recommended this precious metal. Up to 600,000 ounces of this rare metal will be needed by 2030 to produce green hydrogen. Nick is doubling down on this pick, and you should too. Call Nick at AmFed Coin and Bullion to find out more. Another very rich topic here. I'm Dennis Prager. This is the Happiness Hour. The effect of happy or unhappy parents on children. I use this example as my primary example. This and marriage. How unhappy people ruin marriages and how unhappy people ruin children. If you can't help it, you can't help it. Anyway, I'm not asking you to change your feelings. I'm asking you to change your behavior, which ultimately will have an effect on your feelings. That's how important this subject is of being happy. Jane in L.A., known as the city that is imprisoned. Hi.
Dennis. Thank you so much for taking my call this morning. You have no idea what an honor it is to talk to you.
I'm touched. I really am. Thank you.
You're the father figure I never had.
I am for a lot of people, and I'm honored by it, and I'm saddened by it. So you understand both meanings. Go ahead.
I understand. Yeah. I'm with my father here from Connecticut a few months ago. He's 87. He's chronically been depressed and unhappy his whole life, and a compulsive gambler since he was 17, I would say, so 70-year habit. And he has made the statement on several occasions that he lives just for me. When he lived in Connecticut before he moved here, it was, I'm you know, what keeps me going is my next visit to you.
I believe that.
Yep. And then now that he's here, it's, I hate to even say it's burden, because I believe in honor thy father and mother, and I do that with him and spend a lot of quality time with him, but it is a tremendous burden on me to know that his happiness depends on when he sees me.
Yes, this was my last week's topic, which is worth revisiting. That's right. It's a burden on your child if your happiness is dependent upon your child. That's right.
Yes, it is. It is a big burden on me. And my mom was bipolar and out of the picture since I was very young. So,
wait. So both your parents were chronically unhappy.
Yes.
So how do you explain your health?
I struggle with have struggled with anxiety and depression throughout my life. Anxiety, mostly, and it's. Honestly, I listen to you every day, and I can't understate how much you've meant, and that's meant to me and kept me on the right track.
Just for the record.
I don't think it's possible to.
I'm very happy to hear that. So what are you married?
I am engaged, I'm grateful to you in part because I'm engaged to my police officer fiance. I've been married before, and I'm 55, and Dennis, I would curse you when you would talk about online dating on the happiness hour or the male-female hour. Because I was like, Dennis, you have no idea how awful online dating is. You've never done it. I did it for about 8 years on and off before I met the one.
On which site, by the way? I'm always curious.
It was Bumble. It was my first Bumble.
That's one of the most common. Yeah. Hinge is common. Bumble is common. That is so music to my ears. I am so happy for you. You have no idea.
Thank you so much. I can't tell you how much you mean to me.
You have. You really have. I'm happy about that. This is important to me. That's really all I wanted to do with my life, is touch people's lives for the better. My desires in life are so corny that it's almost difficult to say them, because it sounds, as I said, corny. That's what I want, though. Since high school, I wrote it down in my diary, which I kept then, and I should have continued, but I'm lazy. So I didn't continue my diary. Gambling. People talk so much about drug addiction, but they don't talk nearly as much about gambling addiction. It's a real life ruiner. You know what I think it is? Adrenaline addiction. We'll be back.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Some lawyer hit a little girl.
The community is left in shock as former cancer patient Sharon Blackwell was struck by an oncoming vehicle.
Take this in evidence, sir.
I need to call my wife.
You've been accused of texting while driving.
We don't make an example out of this guy, the public will crucify us.
Before you take your daughter off life support, give God room to be God.
You're not guaranteed another day, but you have today. The moon.
Get back or I'll shoot you.
No one's left inside for the pastor and his two daughters.
If you run, I'll shoot your family.
Nobody cares whether I live or die.
It's bad. I'm not gonna stand around and be a part of it anymore. Give me the gun.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Las Vegas, I mean, it is open for business. It is wide open. It's unreal how different things are. in a place like Las Vegas. I mean, this, somebody look up, Derek, see how many seats the O show at the Bellagio holds. How many seats are in that theater? The show is called O at the Bellagio. See how many seats it holds. It was packed. I mean, there's no social distancing going on in Las Vegas. There just isn't. Now, does that disturb you? Or does that make you happy? Does it bother you to know that there are communities that, like Las Vegas, that have a theater that I sat in and was in amazement at the Las Vegas production of O at the Bellagio with 1,800 seats, and it was packed. It was sold out. There weren't seats between other seats. There weren't empty seats blocked out with stupid X marks. And incidentally, on the topic of Las Vegas, may I respectfully suggest a must-see show if you like Vegas like I do. I don't do a whole lot of gambling. I don't drink. I don't smoke. I love the theaters. I the shows. I love the hotels. I love the restaurants. I love the vibe of Las Vegas. The magic of Jen Kramer at the Westgate is a must-see.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Great. We've had 6 months of the new administration. It is the farthest thing from moderation that the government has ever seen. And it is the fastest track to extremism that we've ever had elected.
But Kevin, how did I know that in advance? Why in my debate with David French did I know this and you knew this? There was no question in my mind. So the fact that this has now happened, you know, part of me wants to say, ha ha, but it's just too sad to say ha ha. This is something that I warned against and you warned against and others warned against because we knew that the consequences are devastating.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com.
If you realize how important this happiness hour is, may I tell you that 99% of them are equally important? On all of them available at PragerTopia.com. One of the least expensive, life-changing investments you could make. And get every show without commercials, I might add. PragerTopia.com. Your opening up to me in these calls is very powerful. It's very powerful to everybody listening. I'm a big believer in opening up. My theory is, what's the worst that could happen? Somebody abuses that openness? Okay, so you leave that person. A risk-free life is a dead life. Okie dokie, everybody. The subject is unhappy or happy parents. The interesting thing is, I think every call is about unhappy parents. I'm glad I had happy parents because I have the chance to at least speak about the advantage of that. I had disadvantages. I told you they were not affectionate. They were certainly when I was older. No question about that. But they weren't when I was a kid. And nevertheless, I'll take that trade-off any day. Because most of your life, you're not a child. You don't think that when you're a child. It seems so long, childhood. Remember how long a year was when you were 7 years old? Now you know how long a year is. they're absurdly quick. So the vast majority of your life, you're an adult, at least chronologically an adult. Many people do not achieve that status in terms of maturity. And then if your parents are happy and don't rely on you for their happiness, that is just one spectacular gift. All right, everybody. Well, we got some really powerful calls here. Oh, man. Diane in Arizona, hello.
Dennis, my name is Diana, and I'm assuming it's me.
Yes, my error. I should go to the punishment room. Hold on a minute. I'm entering the punishment room. Oh, no, wait a minute. Sean isn't here. He doesn't know how to operate it. That is hilarious. I deserve the punishment room, but I'm not going in. Because William does not know where the punishment room is. All right, we can't take more time on it. That's the wrong one. Okay, Diana, go ahead.
Thank you.
Wait a minute. Wait. It's a terrible connection. Hold on. We're not here. You sound like you're underwater.
Can you hear me?
No, it's really... I'm gonna put you on hold because I really want your call. She was raised by a Holocaust survivor. And I'm very, very interested in her call. Mary in Philadelphia, hi.
Hi, how are you?
I'm well, thank you.
Good. I am a now happy adult who was raised by a very unhappy, clinically depressed mother and a very happy father.
Poor man.
Pardon me?
Poor man. I feel bad for him being a happy man
married to a clinically
depressed person.
Yeah, and you know, my really early childhood, I remember feeling very secure. I didn't feel that depression from her until he took a job far away from her family. And that seemed to kind of set this off.
How old were you?
Well, I was around 7 when we moved, but I didn't really feel it until maybe I was 10 or 11.
And her depression?
Yes. Yes, I didn't recognize it,
All right, fine. And you felt it then, and its effects were?
It scared me. It scared me to hear my mother cry at night.
Oh, God, that's terrible. That is so sad. Oh, God. My heart goes out to both of you.
Thank you. I often felt like this really intense fear that I would come home and I would find her dead. Because
God.
At that point in you know...
Why, because you thought she would kill herself?
Yeah, I did.
Oh, my God. So what happened? Did your father come back to the house?
Oh, no, my father was with us at this point in time. He traveled a lot with his job. And my mother had no family, no support system where we lived.
Right, well, that's what I'm referring to. When did he return permanently to the house? Or did he ever?
He was always permanently at the house. He did travel for work, but he knew all of this was going on, and he was a huge support to her. I remember driving hours.
Well, he's a great man. We don't have a lot of time. How did it affect you, if at all?
I think it made me very insecure as a child. I think it made me feel like I wasn't good enough because I couldn't create this happiness.
See? That's what happens. I said that. The happy want to take care of the unhappy and fix them up. But you can't. You can only fix yourself.
Streaming on Salem Now.
218 out with him. Headed for the house. He's got a hostage.
You believe in God, Chip? Why does a kid die? Drug dealer get off scot-free?
Well, the only answer to that is there isn't a God.
You have a choice. You can either let the darkness overtake you, or you can be a bearer of the light.
So just think of it as calling for backup.
Officer down, officer.
You're the one God's called to be a shepherd.
Keeper, do you know who I am?
You are the author?
I am.
I don't know you.
Keeper, it's your son.
Hurry it up! Time is short.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
And so, Don, a question I get a lot and where people are emailing us freedom@charliekirk.com right now is, how is your family holding up in the midst of this? How is your father holding up? I mean, after delivering results for our country, doing everything he said he was going to do, people kind of take me aside. They say, hey, how are they hanging in there? Any insight you can give us, Don, into that?
Yeah, listen, we're doing well, you know, maybe because we're a bit masochistic. We sort of like to be in the fight. And more importantly, because the fight is worth it. I mean, you brought up, you know, opening this thing, you know, my book, Liberal Privilege, like it's literally about all of these things, you know, whether it's, you know, whether it's the sort of faulty persecutions, whether it's the ongoing aspects of this. I mean, look at what's going on. Even, you know, take January 6th. OK, and say what you want about it. Like if you commit a crime, you should commit a crime. But the FBI and the highest levels of law enforcement, anyone who is, you know, if you are within about 2,000 miles of Washington, D.C., and you're a conservative, it's like the FBI is putting a, have you seen this man? He was seen somewhere within 1,500 miles of D.C. that day. Let's find him. But 13, 14 months of looting, of arson, burning our cities down, taking over buildings. Charlie, I've been told that that's insurrection. I've been told that's insurrection, and yet there doesn't seem to be any interest in looking into that insurrection. It's total pass. And this is how disgusting it's been. And that's my point. I guess we have to stay in the fight. We have to be engaged. You and I both understand how much of a disadvantage you are in if you're a conservative. You understand, you get no help from the mainstream media. You get no help from print media. You get no help from social media. Frankly, they're working actively against us.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Play it loud. I love this song. Yeah, that's right. You could be happy if you've a mind too. Let's see if the daughter of our Holocaust survivor in Arizona is clearer now. Diana, hello.
Hello, Dennis. Can you hear me?
Yes, I do. Go ahead.
You are such my hero. I cannot believe. Ironically, I was just coming from a 12-step AA recovery meeting where in that meeting, we have to see the world with the water half in the glass instead of half out of the glass. And I was just describing in one of my shares about how my father, an immigrant from Poland who married my mother from Russia, came to this country in 1952. And I learned as a little girl how to mistrust and dislike the entire universe. And it wasn't until 5 years ago when I walked into the rooms of AA and I was told that I had to find a higher power that would comfort me and protect me. I did not know what happiness was. Although I have listened to you for many years, it never hit my heart until... And here's the irony. I'm driving home from this meeting, and I listen to you all the time, and I thought, you know what? I'm just going to pick up the phone and call, and it'll be God working in my life if I get through. And I got through. It's just shocking to me. This is one of the, these are the miracles that I see every day. And I just want to tell you that my parents taught me how to be unhappy and how to yell and scream and be afraid. And I taught my children the very same behavior.
Wow.
And I am now 61 years old, and I spent most of my life being unhappy myself. Mm. And I've been with the same man now for 39 years. Mm. And at around 30 years, he decided he couldn't live with me anymore. Did not know that I suffered from addiction because I hid it so well.
Well, what a story. I got to like, oh my God, I wish I could talk to you for an hour. I really do. Oh, listen. It's a subject unto itself. The children of Holocaust survivors are as affected by the Holocaust as the Holocaust survivors. But what a powerful thing, an ode to AA. I love AA. God bless you, folks. Another powerful hour. Now call in on any subject under the sun.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Surprise!
Sharon and I.
Sharon and you what?
Things just happened.
My girlfriend and my best friend.
You got 30 days to grow up, son.
Nathan Hanning, it is good to have you home.
Nona, Nona, it's Nathan.
Well, you don't mind my giving her your room, do you?
Really, though, thanks for thinking of me for this position.
I thought about you first. Come on, growing up, I had a huge crush on you.
There are things that we all need to change about ourselves, but we can't blame God because He helps us change.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Larry Elder Show.
You were talking about Bill Cosby, and I kind of disagreed with you about you were saying about all the women. I might say maybe half, what is it, 18 women?
Oh, no, it's close. It's close to 50 women that have made allegations.
50?
50, 5-0.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. So you believe in, you believe all of them are.
Well, you think all 50 are lying, including Beverly Johnson, one of the first black major models in America? She said he also gave her drugs and tried to rape her.
I'm a woman, and what I'm saying is, and there in Hollywood, he's a high profile man,
mm-hmm.
and they wanted to be alone with him. They might not have wanted his advances, but it's kind of Lynn, please.
There's no doubt that because he was famous and rich, he attracted women. The question is, did he drug them and have sex with them? And that's known as rape.
Answer that. That's what I'm saying. If they drank anything that he had,
right.
They willingly drink
Lynn, hold on a second. The reason Bill Cosby got released is because the prior prosecutor apparently entered into some sort of deal with him and said, you're not going to be criminally prosecuted if you testify honestly in the civil trial. And in the civil trial, years ago, he testified and admitted that he gave that particular woman a drug in order to have sex with her. He admitted it under oath.
One woman. Yes, but not.
How many does it take?
Well, I'm just saying, I know I'm a woman. I know women. I'm not saying some of it didn't happen, but some of them are scorned because they thought they was going to get something out of it.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
What is your message to those who think this isn't a big deal or who feel cowed and intimidated? What do you say to them?
Anytime you say something like what I'm about to say, I'm sure it can be abused and misused, so I'll be very careful in how I say it. I've never read Hitler's Mein Kampf, but I've picked it up recently in the past week because I'm interested in learning everything I can about history. After spending just a day with his Mein Kampf, the spirit and essence of his race hatred that shows up in that book, a set of two books, is very similar to what I'm seeing show up in How to Be an Anti-Racist.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today at rumble.com. Trending now on the Charlie Kirk Show.
I want to talk about what's happening in New York with Letitia James and what I consider to be a political persecution unlike anything, I think, in American political history. How are you guys dealing with this? And do you guys see this as, you obviously said this last night, but as a continuation of almost this five-year political witch hunt?
100%. I mean, it's pretty clear when the attorney general of a state, without any information, literally campaigns on saying, hey, we're going to investigate, we're going to lock them up, we're going to do this, that, and the other. It's pretty amazing that they can get away with it. And then they do it. And then they do it for 5 years. And the reality is this, there's no recourse. There's no one keeping them in check, Charlie. They can just do this. You have nowhere to appeal it to. You're going to appeal it to a leftist judge in New York who feels the same way. They're utilizing their taxpayer-funded offices in a political vendetta to try to damage my father. And the reality is this, even after 5 years, in search of a crime, right? They've been looking for 5 years. They're getting closer, Charlie. We've been hearing this now literally for half a decade, and yet there's still nothing there. And yet no one's stopping them. So as crime rates go through the roof in New York, as murder rates go through the roof, as businesses are going out of business because of New York's disastrous recovery response, they're spending taxpayer dollars on a political witch hunt against Donald Trump rather than, murderers. This is what's going on in America. They're outraged when this stuff happens in, Belarus recently, right?
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
If you're longing for a place that feels like pre-pandemic America, I'll tell you right now, Las Vegas is one of them. What's your community? Well, tell me what your town is like and how you would respond to being in a theater with 1,800 other people, elbow to elbow. Here's Mike. What's the upstate of South Carolina, Mike, life, Mike?
Mike, it is wide open for business, baby. We are rocking and rolling, and we cannot get enough people to work. So come on down here and grab yourself a job.
I love it. That makes me happy. Coming back to work makes me happy. Thank you, Mike.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
This is it, everybody. This is the hour. You set the agenda, whatever's on your mind about you, about me, about life, about death, and, of course, about fountain pens, audio equipment, photography equipment, cigars. Ooh, take it in. Give it to me. Give it to me, William. William's in for Triple G today, ladies and gentlemen. And may I say, he is doing a truly lousy job. That was a joke. That was true. You know why? You know why it was a good joke, though? Because when I say he's doing a truly, he expected me to say wonderful job. That's the reason it was a funny joke. What's the crickets for? The audience. No. The audience are not... Okay. William is putting down my audience. And, you know, that's indefensible. Anyway, whatever's on your mind. And let me say to the screener, if she hears me, no matter what the living martyr said, I do accept calls on the subjects that he finds boring, namely my favorite subjects, which is really funny. So it is, my friends. Whatever is on your mind. And let us know. Go to a favorite of mine, Tom of Alvin, Texas. We know him all here as Tom of Alvin.
Hi, Dennis. I wanted to say hi to Triple G, but I guess he's not there. I'll say hi to Double H if she's there. But my question is, when will we be able to see a Stories of Us episode from Julie Hartman?
Why would you like to?
Hello?
Yeah, I say, why would you like to?
Oh, that's where you have the videos
for
people who have converted. Converted from one, become conservative.
Oh, I see. Oh, that's good. That's why I'm glad I asked you. That's the truth. She would fit in perfectly there. Right. Well, as it happens, I have invited her to sit in for me when I'm in Hungary in August, giving a speech. And cool. She will actually take over the show. The young, maybe the youngest person to ever host a national radio show. I certainly don't know anybody her age who's done it. It gives you an idea of how highly I esteem her, that I would entrust her with my show for 3 hours. All right, everybody. Tom of Alvin. She wanted to hear your voice because, as I said, you're sort of a legend here with your hilarious emails to Triple G. You're the only person we know in Alvin. It's funny to think I live in Alvin. It reminds me of the people in Washington. Do you know that Washington State has a city named George? They literally live in George Washington. That is priceless. All right, everybody. Isaac, Los Angeles, hello.
Hi, Dennis. This has been on my mind about a month ago, especially during the height of systemic racism and all that nonsense. I live in Los Angeles, and for the past 50 years, it's normal to open a door for a black person, hold it open, they hold it open for you. You may give a nod, you may give a smile, where you actually have some form of almost contact. And what I noticed a month ago or 2 months ago is not only did that continue to happen, but even walking down the parking lot, if a black person was coming the other way, we said hello, we said hi. Gave a smile, whatever, something that we would never do before. It's something that wasn't happening because there was no need to. And yet, during the height of it,
that's an interesting insight. That's a very interesting insight. I don't know what's happening in race relations. I didn't think that they were problematic to begin with. But you're arguing that it's getting better. Because people are going out of their way, both races. Interesting. I have no comment. I'm fascinated by the insight. I certainly hope it's true. I have my whole life treated blacks like, to the best of my knowledge, anybody else. And, people say they have affection for a group. I don't have any affection for groups. I have affection for individuals. I'm a big individualist. Right? Only two races, the decent and the indecent, said Viktor Frankl, who went through Auschwitz. If you're a young person, I probably have to explain Auschwitz. The fact that I have to explain it speaks volumes about your education. Okay, that's a good one, Isaac. I appreciate that. And in Springfield, Illinois, it is the famous Todd. Hello, Todd.
Hi, Dennis. Hey, with Congress throwing around trillion-dollar bills now like they're confetti, you know, a trillion used to be a number no one would touch, and now it's just commonplace. It seems like every bill they come out with is a trillion. You have talked in the past about how people can't really put their hands between a billion and a trillion. It's so
right.
It's so incomprehensible. I've got kind of a good way of illustrating the difference. If you had a printing press that produced $1 a second, you would have to run the printing press 31 and a half years to get $1 billion.
Oh my God, is that interesting? A billion?
Yes, and
wait, a billion seconds is 32 years?
32 years. You would have had to start the printing press during the early Reagan administration to get $1 billion. Now, when I tell you a trillion, a lot of people aren't going to believe it, but you can go do the math after the show.
Well, I'll tell you, right? 32,000.
You can use Oregon math and get whatever answer you want. But
that's true.
To get the same printing press producing $1 bill a second,
right?
You would have had to start it 31,000 years ago.
That's what I said. I got it because it's 1,000 billion. As I said yesterday on the radio, talking about the crushing of the American life with this $3.5 trillion plan, it is not possible to overstate how damaging it is to America economically and humanly. What we're doing is we are being pushers. The government is now a drug pusher. The drug is free money. More powerful than any drug is free money. And it will be impossible to revoke, because once people have it, it's like revoking heroin from a heroin addict. I said that a trillion is a bad word. It should be 1,000 billion. That would at least make people think a little bit. 1,000 billion. So I guess what would it be? 100,000 million? No, that's not as effective. Yep. We are going from about 20% of the GDP is government spending to 25% in one bill. The highest in American history. It's truly entering the realm of socialism, where the government is the owner of the economy. All right, let's see here. And, all right, we took that one. Dan in Hopkins, Minnesota. I know you've tried to call in on this for weeks, and here you are.
Bless your heart.
Yes, indeed.
I asked God. I said, God, prick Dennis's heart to pick.
It worked. It worked. There you go. You're the second one today to pray to get on the show, and it worked.
You are a gem. You're such a highly esteemed, in my wife's eyes, my eyes.
Great, thank
you.
And
we thank God for you every day.
Wonderful.
Something, I'm a plumber. That's what I do for a living, and I try to do what I can to fight, because I know you are a warrior for the cause of truth and conservatism. The really very saddening and troubling thing for me and my wife is the lack of coverage on all of the stuff that's come out about the fraud of November 3. And when you think about dear President Trump, a lot of these problems that we are so upset about, you name it, a lot of it goes away.
Yeah, hold on. I'm going to keep you on.
Trending now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Donald Rumsfeld is famous for many things. Before Donald Trump, there was Newt Gingrich in the 2012 campaign, demonstrating hostility to the media and confrontation with the media. But before there was Newt Gingrich, there was Donald Rumsfeld, demonstrating command of the media. Most famous for his combination of command and concise knowledge is this cut, which is his most famous response to a question.
There are reports that there is no evidence of a direct link between Baghdad and some of these terrorist organizations.
There are known knowns. There are things we know we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns. The ones we don't know, we don't know.
Excuse me, but is this an unknown unknown?
I'm not
several unknowns, and I'm just wondering.
I'm not going to say which it is.
But Mr. Secretary,
I'm right here.
See, Rumsfeld knew exactly what he's doing. It makes perfect sense, and that's why his memoir is known as Known Unknowns. But for the full tutorial on how to deal with the media, here is a press situation with Donald Rumsfeld on April the 11th. 2003, listen to how he deals with a hostile press.
I picked up a newspaper today, and I couldn't believe it. I read 8 headlines that talked about chaos, violence, unrest, and it just was henny penny, the sky is falling, I've never seen anything like it, and here is a country that's being liberated.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
When did you wake up and say, hang on, this is not good?
Well, like I said earlier, I've been in for over 15 years. The first 14 years of my career, I was in the Air Force, was in the flying community, and then came into the Space Force. Every unit that I've ever been in, all of my professional interactions with people during the preponderance of my career have been highly professional, not politicized. We focus on a mission that unifies us. We wear the same uniform and we go out and do our job every day. And when I noticed personally these things really rapidly beginning to change was in the past calendar year, but specifically in the aftermath of George Floyd's death. What you saw in broader society in the form of social justice activism pouring into the streets, the disruption of civil liberties, for example, and the dialogue, if you want to call it that, that ensued in the aftermath is the very thing that I saw just spill over into active duty military units. Now, I'll be clear that every unit is different, every leader is different, every base is different, but that's when I was really keen on seeing this happen. Now, I've been in academia for the past 2 years, and so what I'm able to share is simply one man's perception of when this is. I left academia in June of last year and came out to my current base and have had these experiences, but it's my sense that the seeds are planted long ago. This is a subversive agenda.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe today.
best chance to meet more wonderful people to bring into your life that you will have under any circumstance. For that alone, it's worth coming. Stand with Israel. Banner is at DennisPrager.com. This is the hour you set the agenda. Dan in Hopkins, Minnesota, I was on with him, and he is preoccupied with the question of why isn't the press preoccupied with all that is coming out about the last election and the counting, correct?
Dennis, actually, I'll go even deeper. Salem Broadcasting isn't sharing and telling American people the fraud and all the mountainous amount of evidence. And there's a character assassination of righteous people like Rudy and Sidney Powell, Mike Lindell, of others, by having the courage to come forth to share what they know. And it's absolutely true.
Well, what's the problem with Salem? I'm having you...
They're not talking about... one host is having people on to talk about.
Oh, I see. Well, that includes me. By the way. That does include me. It's not just my colleagues. So this is a very difficult issue. I have said from the beginning that I am agnostic. And I've been very open about that. I do not know if God had counted the ballots, who would have won. But I am equally certain that Joe Biden would not have won as would have won. I am also certain that they cheated, because Democrats have cheated all of my life. They cheated in the Kennedy-Nixon election. They probably cheated enough for Kennedy to win. And Richard Nixon thought it was not worth pursuing for the sake of the country. Conservatives put the country above power. Leftists have never put power under anything. Second, there is no reason why one who believes that Donald Trump is a fascist, white supremacist, why they would not morally be justified in cheating. I would. I wrote a column on this. I did a show on this. If I believed that some candidate were a racist, white supremacist, neo-Nazi dictator, I would do everything possible, including cheat, if I were in a ballot counting situation. Would I have not cheated to prevent Hitler from becoming chancellor in 1933 in Germany? So they have every reason. Morality defends their cheating. They have cheated all of my lifetime. My friend, who is a moderate Republican, and I say that with respect, he's done a number of PragerU videos, I'm very close to him, Hugh Hewitt. He wrote a book, If It Isn't Close, They Can't Cheat, I think that's the name. Or If It Ain't Close, They Can't Cheat. Yeah, that's exactly right. If it's close, they cheat. So I don't know. I don't know what it will be. I'm waiting for more information. And Dan, you have every right to be upset, and I have every obligation to explain my own view on the issue. I will say this. I think that President Trump made a mistake in being preoccupied with the legitimacy of the presidential election at the price of not being preoccupied with the Georgia 2 Senate seats. I said it at the time, the only thing that matters now is Georgia. I was right. By winning those 2 seats, they are destroying this country by having 50-50 in the U.S. Senate. That, believe it or not, was more important to me than the recounts. The recounts are extremely important. Georgia was more important. This was lost on President Trump. This was lost on many of those who love the president. Okay. And now they have the Senate. It's 50-50, but they have it because when it's 50-50 and you have the vice president, you have it. Now, it's very fair to say, was Georgia there's the Georgia recounts or the Georgia special elections. Were they honest? Given what was just found out about in Fulton County, I don't know. Let me put it to you this way. Of this I am certain. If Democrats could cheat, they cheat. There is nothing that would stop them from doing so. They lie, they cheat. They do so because all leftists lie and cheat. Liberals don't, conservatives don't. Some conservatives do, some liberals do. All leftists do. I read to you yesterday a gigantic lie in the Los Angeles Times. One day, one article, one huge lie. That Larry Elder distorts the facts, twists, that's the word, twists the facts about black criminality in America. Zero basis for making it. It was 100% lie that the LA Times published. Not 99%, 100%. Only when you realize that there is nothing stopping the left from lying and cheating, nothing, that they feel morally pure in doing so, can you understand why some people legitimately think that the last election was stolen. Because there is no reason that Democrats wouldn't do it if they could. That's it. So I'm glad you called. Allowed me to explain that. All righty, everybody. Mark in Zagreb, Croatia. Hello, Mark.
Hello, Mr. Brager. This is Mark from Croatia with my friend from Macedonia, if you remember.
I remember it so well. I talk about it at speeches. When you tell me, when I asked you, how did you hear about my show, you told me it was your friend in Macedonia. I really love that.
Okay. So, many people consider helping your family to be very noble. Sometimes my mom would say I volunteer to help before. She complains. She says, like, why don't you help your own family, even though my family is not struggling and there's nothing that I can help them with. And I've noticed that a lot of people compliment people who help their family, but when you think about it, so many bad people in the world help, almost all bad people help their, treat their families great, and they help them.
Yeah, like the mafia. They're known for that. That's a very good question. I shall return to it momentarily.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
Men and women died in Vietnam or the other wars that we fought for our flag.
Hey, what a great call. What a great point that is. To disrespect those men who spilled blood, who left their limbs on the battlefield the way the left is doing. Chris, you're on the Mike Gallagher Show. How you doing, Chris?
Good, Mike. It's a nice honor to talk to you finally.
Thank you, Chris. I appreciate that. Honor to speak to you as well.
Mike, I'll make this real quick. I'm probably not all that great at talking on air, but all I am is a lifeguard on the ocean front in Southeast North Carolina.
Right.
And I just want to say that, you know, this weekend we had outstanding weather. The crowds were fantastic. Everyone was just well behaved.
Wow.
And Mike, I was on my tower. I was on my tower and I was looking north. And I saw the thousands and thousands of people with their umbrellas, you know, thousands of people in the water just enjoying. The kids were playing. The kids were running around and happy cries and screams were going on. Mike, in my binoculars, you know, you got a picture of this. You got the city line and the beach and the ocean. But in my binoculars, I saw all of this going on. And then in the center was the American flag waving. And it just... Mike, it just brought me to tears sitting in my tower watching this just thinking thinking about all the people who disrespect our flag and, like your last caller, all the men who died for this country. It just brought me to tears sitting on the tower watching all this going on.
And you know what? You got to keep reminding yourself, millions and millions of Americans feel just the way you and I do. Chris, we're not alone. We're not in the minority.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Get back or I'll shoot you.
No one's left inside for the pastor and his two daughters.
If you run, I'll shoot your family. Nobody cares whether I live or die.
It's bad. I'm not going to stand around and be a part of it anymore. Give me the gun.
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
I had studied Marxist history, beginning with Marx and Engels' Communist Manifesto from 1848. And when I first studied that and saw in section one of the manifesto what you can recognize as what's called the oppressor versus oppressed narrative of human history, a whole bunch of stuff that was taking place in our country began to become exceptionally clear to me. And I began to piece together a lot of the what I'll call militant impulse that was manifesting in society as time went on. And there's a victimhood ideology. There's constantly an effort by some individuals who have an agenda to pit groups of people against one another as victims or oppressed groups and oppressor groups. And we've seen very clearly over the past calendar year who the oppressor group is labeled to be and who the oppressed groups are labeled to be. And right now, under the auspices of diversity and inclusion training, as well as critical race theory and other narratives of American history that have been parading about throughout the country and showing up in our education system, all of those narratives seek to divide the American people by pitting.
Hi, all. Dennis Prager here. All right. Was I on with anybody? That is the question. Yes, I was with Mark in Zagreb in Croatia. So the question on the table is, do you first help strangers or your family? Is that the question?
Yeah, I mean, according to the Bible, shouldn't it be more noble to help strangers who are more in need of help than your family?
Because Wait, it's not apples and apples then. You're saying that the stranger is more in need.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, so if they're equal, so you agree, equal need, family comes first?
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. So then we're in agreement. Equal need, family comes first, even if you don't like the family. There have to be certain bonds, like honor your father and mother. Father and mother come before a stranger, even if you don't like your father and mother. There've got to be some rules. You can't only be guided by your heart. Guided by the heart is the calamity of America today. The vast number of American young people who are guided by their hearts, and older people too, but especially younger people, they have no body of literature to guide them like the Bible. The idea is preposterous to them. I'm going to look to the Bible to know what is right. I look to my heart. Problem is, your heart is the crappiest place to look for what is right. Just for the record, every evil movement appealed to the heart. Indeed, they were guided by their hearts. There's a Hebrew saying, Mark, in Zagreb. The Hebrew saying is, Aniyeh ircha kodmim, the poor of your own city come first. That's not a family question, but it is a good example of, do I help the poor of my own city first, or the help Do I help the poor of another city first? Okay, everybody. Thank you, my friend in Zagreb. And let's see here. Patty. I mentioned age on a rare occasion. Patty is 90, is that correct? Colorado Springs?
Right. Right.
So how's your health, Patty?
Hello?
Yeah, that might have answered my question.
Hey, no, I am 90, right.
Right. How is your health?
Oh, it's wonderful. It's wonderful. I have a great life.
So what's your secret, or is it your secret luck, good luck?
Just good luck. Just good luck, and I love the Lord.
Good luck and love the Lord is a good combo. All right, what's on your mind? What's on your mind?
Well, I was wondering if there's something behind this COVID vaccine that's just more than the vaccine. It seems like here in Colorado, they're giving away $1 million prizes and scholarships and even beer if you go have a vaccination. And to me, it seems like there's another something in back of all this, but some kind of a plan.
I couldn't agree with you more. There's something fishy about the whole thing. Get vaccinated, force vaccination on young people who don't need it. That's criminal. Force vaccination on young people. Don't let them go to school if they don't get vaccinated, announce our cesspools known as universities. There's something vicious going on. I don't know fully. I think it's a combination of the corruption of the medical profession that has taken place, where fools have come into power at the AMA, at the JAMA, at the NEJM, New England Journal of Medicine, Lancet in England, and the American Psychiatric Association is no different from the ACLU. So it's that, and the pharmaceutical companies, billions of dollars, hundreds of billions of dollars. There's no question that plays a role. The last, or one of the last, FDA commissioners is now on the board of Pfizer. Does that raise any issues with any of you? Well, if it doesn't, then I really have nothing to add. Relieffactor.com, 800-500-8384. I actually, before the show today, I met the doctor behind Relief Factor. What an impressive guy. He radiates competence. Some people do, as you know. He's one of them. And I asked him how he discovered this. And anyway, it's a very laborious process. He actually developed it first for a chiropractor to help alleviate neck and back and hip and joints and muscles in general pain. It's the greatest thing that is not a drug available for that. Try it for 3 weeks, because in 3 weeks you'll know if it works. Just $19.95 for the 3 week tryout. Relieffactor.com.
Streaming on Salem Now.
Things just happened.
My girlfriend and my best friend.
You got 30 days to grow up, son.
Nathan Hannigan, it is good to have you home.
Nona, it's Nathan.
Well, you don't mind my giving her your room, do you?
Stream on your phone, tablet, or TV. Look for Salem Now in the App Store or go to salemnow.com.
Trending now on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Donald Rumsfeld is famous for many things. Before Donald Trump, there was Newt Gingrich in the 2012 campaign, demonstrating hostility to the media and confrontation with the media. But before there was Newt Gingrich, there was Donald Rumsfeld, demonstrating command of the media. Most famous for his combination of command and concise knowledge is this cut, which is his most famous response to a question.
There are reports that there is no evidence of a direct link between Baghdad and some of these terrorist organizations.
There are known knowns. There are things we know we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns. The ones we don't know, we don't know.
Excuse me, but is this an unknown unknown?
I'm not.
Several unknowns, and I'm just wondering.
I'm not going to say which it is.
But Mr. Secretary,
I'm right here.
See, Rumsfeld knew exactly what he's doing. It makes perfect sense, and that's why his memoir is known as Known Unknowns. But for the full tutorial on how to deal with the media, here is a press situation with Donald Rumsfeld on April the 11th. 2003, listen to how he deals with a hostile press.
I picked up a newspaper today, and I couldn't believe it. I read 8 headlines that talked about chaos, violence, unrest, and it just was henny penny. The sky is falling. I've never seen anything like it. And here is a country that's being liberated.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube and at rumble.com. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
When did you wake up and say, hang on, this is not good?
Well, like I said earlier,
Well, everybody, I'm Dennis Prager. If you hear noise in the background, incidentally, it is because I am broadcasting from a building that apparently, in the paranoid state of California in which I live, where, you know, abundance of caution, they have these fire drills periodically that nobody listens to. They just wait until these moronic sounds end and then go back to work. I don't even understand what there is to drill. How you walk down steps. By the way, do they expect us on the 10th floor to walk 10 floors? I mean, in a drill, in a real fire, yes. They're all meeting in the parking lot? Well, good. Maybe somebody will meet somebody terrific and get married. That's how my mind works. Where did you meet? On a fire drill. I think that's cool. People will ask, oh, is that a new app? Is that a new hookup app? Tinder. Fire drill. Hinge. Hinge is not a hookup. I'm not implying it is. All right. Even though I have no doubt some people do. All right, everybody. Dennis Prager. And we spoke about the family and stranger issue. By the way, you'll like this. I'm sure you're still listening there in Zagreb, Croatia. He asked, you know, about order of priorities, helping family or strangers. So I have a theory that I don't know if I've ever actually bounced this off you, but I think you will like it. There is a biblical command to love the stranger. One of the reasons I believe that the first 5 books are divine. Nobody ever said in the history of the world prior to that, love the stranger. The idea was preposterous. Nobody would have thought of it. It was so preposterous. Anyway, here's my theory. Ready? The ultimate stranger is in your family. Love the stranger begins by loving a member of your family. It's much easier to love friends than family. You choose your friends. So you really learn to love the stranger by learning people in your family, many of whom are really strangers to you. All right, y'all. And very interesting. Brian, record your jingle for The Living Martyr. I promise to listen to it. Send it along. All right, Jan in Cave Creek, Arizona. Hello.
Well, hello there, Professor Dennis.
Thank you for the title.
You deserve it. Real quick, I have a question, and maybe you can help me connect the dots. I've been doing a lot of reading of the books that have been recommended, like Fahrenheit 451, and I've noticed that actors and artists like Tim Robbins, Tom Hanks, are involved in these projects and these reading these books, and even Tim Robbins even has an acting theater where he's working with prisoners to help them deal with their anger. And at the same time, he's mocking Trump. Why are these individuals that obviously are gifted artists, study history, supporting something in the leftism that creates less freedom and more censorship?
Yeah. It's a very good question. I asked the question, a variation on it. Why are so many bright people, in other words, people with good brains, foolish? And my answer came to me at Columbia. You can see it on the internet. I wrote this decades ago. How I found God at Columbia. It's actually true. In a nutshell, I was going a little nuts at Columbia University in the early 1970s for the exact same reasons I would go nuts today. It's populated by fools. Moral idiots were teaching me. Many of them nice, many of them very bright, many of them very knowledgeable, and almost all a moral idiot. And it really, really confused me. Why was William Buckley? William, do you have the William Buckley thing there? That he'd rather be governed by the first 1,000 names in the Boston phone book than by 1,000 Harvard professors, which he said at about that time. He probably said it in the 70s. Right. Well, many said he said that because he went to Yale, but he was right. He certainly would be right today. So why would I rather be governed by... One of my previous callers was a plumber. Why would I rather be governed by plumbers than professors? Let alone, as the question was, actors, right? So my answer for Columbia was, it occurred to me, it's the most secular place in America, the university. The most godless institution. And godless and Bible-less produces fools. That, in my opinion, is a fact and not an opinion. The secular world produces knowledgeable people and mostly stupid people. People who cannot navigate life. Maybe they can in their own lives. But they cannot offer navigation rules. They don't understand life. And that was it. Wisdom begins with the fear of the Lord, says the Bible. No fear of the Lord, no Bible, no wisdom. Now you know why America has the problems it does. Because all these people, like in Hollywood and academia think they're gods. Don't you get tired of commercials screaming at you to buy gold now with inflated promises on future values? In an unregulated industry, you need honest, real experts to give you solid advice to protect your wealth and top picks on the best coins and bullion based on real-time data and historical trends. For example, as environmental policy becomes a hot topic, one precious metal that's been significantly undervalued for years is potentially set to surge. Nick Rovich, owner of AmFed Coin and Bullion, has long recommended this precious metal. Up to 600,000 ounces of this rare metal will be needed by 2030 to produce green hydrogen. Nick is doubling down on this pick, and you should too. Call Nick at AmFed Coin and Bullion to find out more. I've been friends with Nick for years, and he's my go-to guy when it comes to coins and bullion. I trust him. He is a good and very knowledgeable man. Call Nick at 800-221-7694. 800-221-7694. AmericanFederal.com. AmericanFederal.com. Not one mistake.
Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
I had studied Marxist history, beginning with Marx and Engels' Communist Manifesto from 1848. And when I first studied that and saw in section one of the manifesto what you can recognize as what's called the oppressor versus oppressed narrative of human history, a whole bunch of stuff that was taking place in our country began to become exceptionally clear to me. And I began to piece together a lot of the what I'll call militant impulse that was manifesting in society as time went on. And there's a victimhood ideology. There's constantly an effort by some individuals who have an agenda to pit groups of people against one another as victims or oppressed groups and oppressor groups. And we've seen very clearly over the past calendar year who the oppressor group is labeled to be and who the oppressed groups are labeled to be. And right now, under the auspices of diversity and inclusion training, as well as critical race theory and other narratives of American history that have been parading about throughout the country and showing up in our education system, all of those narratives seek to divide the American people by pitting people against one another into racial groups.
Yeah, it is.
It's the white versus the black.
It used to be class, division by class. Now it's division by race, by skin color. We've only begun to scratch the surface. We're going to go deep dive on what's happening inside the U.S. military and why this. Hey, everybody, Dennis Prager. I love this hour where you call in on anything. Brian in Baltimore says he sent Corolla, I guess Adam Corolla, a fountain pen. What does that mean? Brian in Baltimore, you sent Adam Corolla a fountain pen?
Yes, I think a couple of years ago, you had gotten him on a fountain pen kick, and he talked about it on his podcast. So I sent him a Lamy fountain pen, which are my workhorses, and as well as a little thing of ink. And I never heard back from him, so I think I chose the wrong type. So
well, you can't, you know, look, it's impossible to respond when you're a public figure. You can't respond to everything. I try to respond to gifts, which are almost always cigars, which I'm very touched by. But you should all know that. Don't hold it against people. I mean, if you send them a car, I mean, if you'd sent Adam Carolla, you know, a 1945 Chevy, in perfect working condition, you would have gotten a response. He's a very wonderful guy. Very close to him. Lucky me. And so I don't know what to say. I'll ask him if he ever remembers getting a fountain pen. I didn't know he was into them. Benjamin, Gainesville, Florida. Hello.
Hey, Pragersaurus. Thanks for having me on your show.
Yes.
I have a quick question for you, and it's this. If I buy a single cigar from the local cigar shop, I like it, and then order it in bulk online, do you think that violates the storekeeper's law?
You know what? First of all, let me just say, what a credit to you and what a credit to me that you made this call.
Well, thank you.
I'll tell you that a 21-year-old would be morally serious. What is your religion?
Oh, that's I identify as a deist, to be honest with you. I identify as a deist, yeah. Uh-huh.
So would you say you're an ethical monotheist? My term?
You could say that, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I like that term.
I think that's great. Where did you hear about the storekeeper law? From me, or did you read it from me?
I think I both read it from you and also
yes.
on
so your... here's the law, everybody. It's a Jewish law. You cannot enter a store and ask the storekeeper the price of an item if you know you won't buy it. You can't raise a storekeeper's hopes for no good reason. So he bought one cigar at a local cigar store. That's how he discovered he liked it. Can he now buy it online? Of course you can. The question is the spirit of the law. Good one, my friend. I'm proud of you. Have a wonderful weekend, everybody.